If I were in the forest and there were a bunch of flowers there, and I saw a flower that had the color on the left side, I would have said to myself while I was in the forest, this is electric blue. The reason that I would have said that is 34 years ago, I worked in the fashion industry. Well, we're making shirts. And I know when a color causes me to say electric. It is more vibrant and more glossy than the original hue. So I would have said electric blue. And then if I went back to my computer and I loaded the image and I saw electric blue, I would have said my camera exposed correctly. It's the correct color. However, if I had the color on the right, since I didn't know how it was called, I had no word for it. I would have a real hard time remembering what the actual color looked like when I was back at home on my computer. I'm saying this because for the life of me, I could not remember what actual color these flowers were. And I was not sure whether the camera exposed them correctly. So a couple of days later, I had to drive by from the same location to verify that the color was correct. But I would not have remembered it unless I gave it a word, so that my brain associates the color with a word. But we have other words that we use in photography that help us associate things quite quickly. For example, we say skin tone. And if the skin tone is realistic, we say it's fine. The non-photographer with an iPhone never checks these details. He thinks the photograph is fine. He hasn't trained his brain to know these details or overblown white. He won't see it. That is because, starting from the fact that humans do not actually understand language, I mean, humans are trained to associate a sound, which is when we pronounce a word, we make a sound, right? Or written symbols with an object or a commonly shared and agreed upon idea. So, for example, if I tell you the Greek word Karekla, you will probably think that I'm talking about this exotic island with a volcano that the locals call Karekla, right? Well, this is Karekla, but how would you know that this is Karekla? The reason that you did not understand my word and you just phonetically associated it with something else, something random, or something that sounds like probably could this and that, whatever you had in your mind at that time, is that you have not been taught that the sound Karekla refers to this object. Humans do not understand language all by itself. They have to associate a spoken word, which is a sound, or written symbols with a specific object. But it goes the other way too, and that's the important part for photography. If you see an object for the first time in your life, and you do not have a word to associate it with, nobody gives you the word. Nobody has trained your brain to associate the object with the word. Most likely, you don't even remember how the object looked like.
If you look at these 12 colors, can you spot the one that's different? You might think clearly it's this one, but when presented with a similar chart, the Himba people of Namibia, who don't have a separate word for blue, take longer to point out this distinction. On the contrary, when looking at green colors, they are more quickly able to note the difference that we wouldn't catch as quickly, this one. And this is because they have more words for types of green than we do in English. In fact, one of their color categories clumps some types of blue and green together, while they have other color categories for different greens still.
The reason they identify the different color faster is that they have a word for it. So they have trained their brain to associate a word with a specific color. And to tell you the truth, most Westerners, the only reason that we see this green as different is because we see it next to each other, next to the other ones. If we see this green separately, you will agree that we won't be able to associate the word to it because we have not trained our brain to see the difference. In other words, to remember a color and to identify it more easily, learn its name. And if you're too lazy to learn its name, I don't know, come up with your own name about it. Have something to associate it with. I do not think that there is anybody who can actually remember colors if they don't know their name. The image fades away really fast from the brain. And that is why people are then trying hard to remember the color by using words of colors that they know and were kind of close to it. They remember that, oh, this color, I remember it was kind of like a purplish. But the brain still brings the image of a purple color, not the exact one that they actually saw. And now let's see how this applies not only to names, but also to concepts. So it is very good to learn the words and associate them with the actual concept. All right, for example, a very common phenomenon, a white dog in the grass. And now this dog, for example, looks a little bit yellowish-greenish, right? I bet you that in reality it's a white dog. But the lens has picked up the reflection from all this green and has painted the entire scene green. Compared to this one, which is a lot better. That's good color separation. Now, if you have trained your brain with the expression color separation, good color separation, it's a blessing and a curse. It's a blessing because you know what's well exposed and what's not, and it's a curse because it may subject you to a lot of editing efforts. Look at the light brownish coloration here on both the model and the dog, and even more evident over here. It says here white dog. Does this look very white to you? More like yellowish, light yellow, light brownish, right? And the correction over here, even in the JPEG file that I just downloaded from the internet, as you saw, can sometimes be as simple as setting the white balance in auto, which does not really work very well with JPEG files in this case. But with a little of manual adjustment over here, all right, you have, where is the before and after in this new freaking software? There you go. I'm having a hard time with a new Adobe thing here. But you see the difference, right? Even from that JPEG that I downloaded, which one do you think is the natural color of the dog? So how strong is the impact of words and definitions on the brain of the amateur photographer? Just grab 50 amateur photographers who have started within the last year or so and tell them color separation and give them one example. That's it, the definition and one example, so that the brain has a reference point. And they're going to start seeing it everywhere. They're going to go into the old pictures that they took and they thought were fine. And they're going to start seeing, oh my God, the faces of these people sitting on the grass are green and my dog is yellow. Things that were right in front of their faces before, but they were not seeing it because their brain did not have a reference point and a definition. No associations. The same with micro contrast, for example. Everybody thought that their old photographs were good, excellent, until somebody all of a sudden gave a name to micro contrast, a definition, and an example, a reference point. And then all of a sudden, everybody started looking at their old pictures, and they discovered that they were not that good in terms of micro contrast. So everybody went nuts, went out to buy new lenses and this and that. But before somebody gave it a name, a definition, and a reference point, an example, nobody was actually seeing it, and it was right there in front of their eyes.
Instead of being inspired, instead of choosing to be positive, instead of like improving constantly on the direction of trying to achieve whatever you have written down, you just sit around and spiral, you know? There's nothing more miserable than sitting around someone who's fucking complaining all the time. It is one of the most annoying things ever. Everybody hates it. When someone just sits around and they complain about their life and they don't do jack shit about it. And you tiptoe around it, you don't know what to say. Well, she gets upset when you bring that up. I don't want to bring that up. And you want to go, you fucking crazy, you know what's wrong with your life. Yeah. Stop announcing it to everybody else and go out and fix that.
I disagree with that last part. I think it is important to vent. And people do complain all the time. They complain at court. They file complaints against each other, right? They organize massive protests or something. People always complain. And you should complain too. Because you have to vent. Before you find a solution, you have to let the big barrier of the grievance that you have in your mind, you have to let it out. Now, where and how you complain, that's important. You do not want to complain on the internet or any public forums or at work, because people do not know what you're talking about, and all they hear is a nagging noise. But you can complain to either people who are close to you, don't overwhelm them though, or to support groups. Regardless of whether you consider them useless or not, and they may be useless, most of them, at least you can complain there, you can vent. Your goal of going there or to a cheap professional is not to find solutions at this stage, it's just to vent. And after that, after you have vented sufficiently and you have started to understand the mistakes of the other side and your side, then you can start recovering and finding solutions. You gotta give a little time to yourself. Videos like that of Joe Rogan are pretty much a method to punish yourself for whatever has happened. You know, oh, I gotta do this, I gotta be more dynamic, I gotta be Superman. 99.9% of people cannot do that. So they end up blaming themselves for not being able to wake up Monday morning and be Superman. So why am I making this segment? Well, because whatever problem you are facing or just faced, complaining and venting are perfectly okay and natural. They're natural reactions. Even in the most insignificant events, such as you hit your toe on the furniture, what is the first thing you do? You go ow, 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 and then you curse at the furniture. This is complaining and venting. Perfectly natural. So go ahead and vent, complain and vent. It's just much better to do, and it's gonna work if you do it in the right setting. Don't spill your guts over the internet because you invite stupid opinions, insufficient communication and interaction, even perhaps stupid criticism. You don't really want that, right? Now, I'm not a professional psychologist and I'm not giving psychological advice here. I'm just talking out of experience. During the venting phase, don't underestimate your problems. You want to go a little dramatic and curse a few times, go ahead and do it, but don't get hostile to others, don't get hostile to yourself. By the last one, I mean don't resort to drinking or drugs or things like that, because instead of one problem, you're going to have multiple. Now, if you think that you're not good in venting because you're not sophisticated enough, they have told you that. My divorce lawyer here in Chicago had told me that the day before, he was waiting for a couple to come in for the settlement. The husband was already there, and they both saw from the window the PhD wife scratching the expensive car of the PhD husband all around. And then she came up. And my lawyer told me that the more money that's on the table, the more possible to lead to violence. And the more educated they are, the more possible it is again to lead to violence, because they have superiority complexes and they think that they deserve a lot better. How to complain and vent in such a way that will not do any harm to you and will eventually lead to finding solutions to keep living a satisfactory life. And that's all I had to say about this.